Welcome back, everybody. Thank you for being here. Priscilla and I were sitting at lunch together, and we were joking that this panel is the last thing between you all and Friday afternoon happy hour. So thank you all for being here. I think it's going to be a really good panel, focusing on law enforcement, surveillance, and Fourth Amendment issues as well. My name is Markus Rauschecker. I am a cybersecurity program manager for the University of Maryland Center for Health and Homeland Security. We are an academic consulting group that does a variety of services in the homeland security, emergency management, public health, and cybersecurity field. We're affiliated here with Maryland Law School. I also teach the law and policy of cybersecurity in a cybercrime course here at the law school and for our new Masters of Science in Law program for non-lawyers. So that they can learn more about legal and policy issues in cybersecurity and other areas of specialty. I'm very thrilled to be here. The program has been great so far today, I think, and I think our panel will be a nice conclusion to the program here today. I want to do quick introductions, and then all of our panelists will have some comments that they want to make about our subject here today, and then we'll, of course, open it up to discussion amongst the panel, and then questions from the audience as well. You have extensive bios in your program, so I won't spend too much time doing the introductions, but over here to my far left, we have Andrew. Andrew Ferguson is a professor of law at the District of Columbia Law School. He's written extensively on the issue of the intersection of technology and law enforcement and surveillance. He's got a book coming out on the issue of big data and policing. He was kind enough to share a working copy of that with us on the panel here, and it really looks fascinating, so I look forward to when it comes out officially. Then we have Priscilla Regan. She is a professor at the Schar School of Policy and Government at George Mason University. Again, she has spent a lot of her work studying the social and the policy and the legal issues surrounding new technologies and implications of those new technologies. She has testified before Congress and has worked with a lot of government agencies on these issues as well, so we have a real expert here. And then to my right, we have Rachel Levinson-Waldman. She is with the Brennan Center with their Liberty and National Security Program. And again, she's an expert on the intersection of technology and policing, focusing heavily on technology, surveillance technology that's being used in public spaces and Fourth Amendment implications. So I'm very excited to hear from all of the panelists, as I'm sure you are as well. And I'll turn it over to Andrew at this point.
First, thank you for being here. These issues affect you and your communities and your family, and they're going to be at the forefront of the legal issues for the next decade and beyond. So it matters that you're sitting in this room on a Friday night thinking and engaging it, and so I thank you for it. I'm talking about big data technologies, because big data technologies are about to and have been revolutionizing what we understand as law enforcement. In police departments today, there is software that predicts future crimes, cameras that record public movement, algorithms that generate virtual most wanted lists of suspects, and data banks that collect personal information, including biometric, consumer, and social media data. Those Twitter accounts you're tweeting right now out of boredom would be collected by someone. There are aerial surveillance technologies that allow police to identify, track, and monitor entire communities, including right here in West Baltimore. Predictive analytics that allow police to interrupt and deter future crimes. Data mining techniques that allow police to find hidden clues in massive data sets. And I've been thinking about how these big data technologies change how we police, the who we police, where we police, when we police, and in some ways, why we police, because they're affecting things on a daily practical level. As this is a panel on surveillance and law enforcement, I want to talk about two aspects of big data policing. First, involving person-based predictive targeting, finding people you want to take out, people you want to identify as being involved or you think are involved in crime. And secondly, place-based predictive policing, targeting communities, targeting areas, targeting neighborhoods. It's really the who and the where that's being changed. And my framework for discussion here is shaped by the book, thank you for mentioning it, I'm writing, that discusses this problem of black data. I contend that all big data surveillance technologies have a black data problem. Black as in opaque because the data exists largely hidden within complex algorithms, black as in racially coded because the data directly impacts communities of color, and black as distorted in creating legal shadows and constitutional gaps where the law used to see clearly. Black data matters because it has real-world impacts. Black data marks human threats with permanent digital suspicion and targets poor communities of color. Black data leads to aggressive stop-and-frisk policies, including deadly force and new forms of invasive surveillance. Big data policing and these new forms of social control must confront this black data problem. Because if it doesn't, it's going to delegitimize whatever positive aspects of these new technologies that are in place now. And we have to do it now because there has been this growing move toward big data policing. And you have to ask yourself why. Why are we at this moment? One answer is the technology is cool. It's techno-friendly, and it seems like that we can learn new things that we didn't know before. But there's also a reality that we are in a world in policing where we're confronting real tensions, right? We've seen protests right here in this city. Places have burned down because people are upset with the tension between citizens and police. And within this movement of technology and tension, there is an attractiveness to the idea that some black box algorithm can solve things, right? If you're the chief of police in Ferguson, Missouri, or the commissioner in New York after stop and frisk has been declared unconstitutional, what do you want to do? You want to have an answer to what's going to happen next. That answer has many times been technology. If you want to trace through Chief William Braddon's career, he's done a wonderful job of dealing with scandal and crisis in police with a response of technology. After the Mullen Commission declared NYPD to be a corrupt institution, he created ComStat, where we use data to sort of determine where crime would be. When LA was overcome by the Rampart scandal, again, Braddon is in charge and brings ComStat 2 and predictive policing to LA. And that right after the NYPD has declared their stop and frisk practice declared unconstitutional, again, it's Braddon who's bringing back new forms of data. We're seeing this now. It's going to be a movement now because it appeals to the police and it also appeals to the community. If part of the problem with policing is our implicit and or explicit bias, you know what, maybe if we use computers, we can move past it. So we're in this world where this is happening now and it's being seen and adopted in communities all across America. So I want to just focus using this lens of big data, this black data idea, and looking at transparency, looking at race, and looking at constitutional distortions to focus on who we police. So let's talk about it. Chicago, Illinois. A knock on an apartment door. A man gives a prognosis to a worried mother. Your son might die. He's at grave risk. Others he knows have already succumbed. An algorithm has identified him most likely to die. This isn't a doctor at the door. It's not some bloodborne pathogen. It's a detective. A detective at a door knocking and saying, we know your son might get shot or might shoot someone. And perhaps we're here to help, but perhaps we're here just to let you know. We know he's involved in no good. This is what's happening. It's called the strategic subjects list in Chicago. It's called the heat list. 1,400 young men, almost all young men of color, have been identified through algorithmic techniques to be the most wanted people. Most wanted not necessarily because they will shoot someone, although that's all part of it, but also because they might get shot. Quasi-public health approach, quasi-social control approach. It's a software that generates this rank order list of potential victims and subjects with the greatest risk of violence. That's not just in Chicago. It's happening in New Orleans, in Rochester, New York, and Los Angeles. They're trying to adopt it to juveniles to identify people who are mostly at risk using big data technologies. So what's the black data problem? One is transparency. Do we know how you get on this list? No, I mean, it's sort of an open secret. People understand that it involves criminal history, arrest, parole status, and whether you've been identified as a gang. But they're real transparency problems, right? You don't know you're on the list until someone knocks on your door. There's no real way to get off of it. You don't know if it's an error. And as the Chicago Tribune reported, there have been errors where people have been knocked, their doors have been knocked, and they have been put on this list because of either a misidentification or their connection to people who are actually victims. So the fact that your friend was shot means you're on this list and suddenly there's a detective at your door. Transparency problems, concerns, but also there is a reality that this list, as sort of big brotherish as it might seem, has been pretty accurate. On a violent Mother's Day weekend in 2016 last year, 80% of the 51 people shot were on the heat list. On Memorial Day later that summer, 78% of the 64 people shot were on the list. So it's troubling, but it's also not necessarily wrong. What about race? Who's on the list? Unsurprisingly to no one. The vast majority, if not all, are young men of color. All are poor. All are from disadvantaged communities. Now, the reality is not simply one of racism, although if you read the DOJ Civil Rights Report and the Chicago Police Department, there is certainly some explicit racism and prejudice that's going on there. But it also involves community networks of people who are the victims of violence, and so those tend to be in similar communities, and the legacy impacts of policing. We know that there have been problems in Chicago and other places where your contacts and thus your intersection with police tends to correlate with your race and your economic status. And if those are the variables going into the forecast and the algorithm, you're going to be on their list. From my point, I like looking at things involving the law, being a law professor. And so I like to study how it impacts the Fourth Amendment. So this heat list, picture you, they're literally right now, there are 1,400 young men of color who are on this list, who are identified as at higher risk of being involved in violence in one way or another. And then you ask yourself, well, how does that impact policing, right? You have police on the street who are going about their daily basis. We have this thing called the Constitution, at least we have it for now, that involves some limitations of what police can do. One of the limitations is reasonable suspicion, whether specific and articulable facts taken with rational inference of those facts warrant the belief that criminal activity is afoot. So in the ordinary course, police are patrolling their ways. They don't necessarily know the people, don't necessarily know everyone in urban Chicago. What they are limited to is what they can see. Their observational clues, what they know about someone is what they can see, what they can sense, maybe a little bit of other information. And generally speaking, that's the way our Fourth Amendment law is developed. It's very small data, right? It's limited to what people can see and do and touch and be involved. But what happens if you take this heat list and you add it to a police officer's knowledge? Now suddenly a police officer is on the street and he sees the person on his list. Not just anyone, someone with the highest score possible. Persons in the area that they know is gang violence, which is pretty much many of the areas where these people will live, the people on the list will live. Is that reasonable suspicion? Looks furtive, looks different, walks away. You can see how easy it is to distort a small data doctrine like the Fourth Amendment reasonable suspicion doctrine with big data. If you add in all of the other information that will and soon will be brought into what we know about people, you can see how much easier it will be to sort of manufacture a level of suspicion. It's a distortion. It doesn't mean it's wrong, but it means that the law is changing, and the law is changing quickly because of these technologies. Quickly about where we police, right? Monday morning, Santa Cruz, California. It's roll call. Every day, police officers receive digital maps of today's crime forecast. Small red boxes, like the ones on the screen, signify areas of predicted crime. They represent an algorithmic forecast of heightened criminal activity. Predictive policing patrols enter the area, and every day police wait in those areas looking for the predicted crime. The theory is if you put police in the box at the right time, you stop the crime. Big cities like New York, LA, Miami, Atlanta, Seattle, and dozens of smaller cities, this idea of predictive policing is happening right now. It's based on a computer model. There's a lot of data behind it. Some of it makes a lot of sense. Social science data that some crimes actually are kind of contagious, sort of viral. If a neighbor's house is burglarized, you got to watch out. They might come for your house. Same with car thefts. There's something about the environment that's causing the crimes to happen. And these things have not only been studied, they've been crunched into algorithms and then used to predict where police should go. Are there black data problems? Again, transparency, race, and constitutional law? Yeah. Transparency problems is many of these proprietary algorithms are proprietary. And in fact, there's sort of this small arms race about companies trying to sell their products to policing, and they don't want to give up their algorithm because that's their company, right? Why would you give up the algorithm? The second problem is it involves math, and most people don't understand math. But it's real because, you know, you're asking police administrators, you're asking city council members and mayors to actually crunch the algorithm that they just can't understand. There's a real transparency problem. We also don't know how the crimes are counted, which crimes are counted, data error. Some companies are much better than others actually about being transparent about it. But at the end of the day, part of the reason for it is that there's this nice black box solution to it, right? Hey, we got this magic box that's going to predict crime. Don't worry about it. Does it impact race? Of course it does. Maybe not as obvious as you would think, because it also depends on which of the variables you're putting in. There's different systems. Some are based on arrest, and the arrest systems actually do have a race-based problem, right? You predict a hot spot, you send police to that spot, you arrest people, those numbers that get put into your algorithm, repeat, 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 you're going to create a self-fulfilling prophecy. But some companies are aware of that, and they try to find, well, maybe we won't look at arrests, we'll look at calls for service. What are the actual crimes? If your house was burglarized, your house was burglarized. It wasn't necessarily based on the place the police went, they're responding to you. And so there is a question. Certainly there are dangers of race-based impacts. It isn't necessarily race, but it creates something that we need to look at. And finally, the Fourth Amendment, right? If you, those law students and law professors and lawyers, understand that the high crime area is one of the factors that police can take in when they're looking for Fourth Amendment reasonable suspicion. So you can imagine when you're that police officer and you're driving through your area and suddenly, oh, I'm in the red square, I'm supposed to be on the lookout for a burglary. Hey, look, there's a guy with a bag. Normally, a guy with a bag isn't enough to stop someone, but I'm in a burglary box, so I'm going to look, I'm going to stop him, I'm going to see what's going on. And you can see how this, in a sort of malleable legal doctrine, it gets that much easier. And it's even harder for the courts who then have to evaluate. It's one thing for the police to stop them, that's bad, but then the courts, how's the court going to parse the algorithm? How are they going to be able to understand what to do with this factor in the totality of circumstance? What they usually do is they'll say, sounds good, I'm a judge, I'm a lawyer, I'm not an algorithm person, I think I'll trust it. So you can see how there is this distortion of it. There's legal theories behind it, like whether we should look at predictive policing as a data-driven tip, like, you know, someone calls in and says, hey, there's a drug area, or is it like a profile of a neighborhood? Is there a collective knowledge, like a partner saying, hey, look out, be on the lookout for this area? They're all actually legally permissible in the sense of they're doctrinally sound, but there's a real question of how it should impact. And you can see the point here, and I'm going to finish because I want everyone else to talk here, is that there are problems with how big data technologies intersect with policing. And these problems trend toward creating transparency problems, race problems or bias problems, and constitutional problems. And the potential for these new technologies, which is real and will move forward, must be answered by resolving some of these questions. And so I'm going to stop there. I know my colleagues here are going to talk about some of the other issues, and I look forward to it. So thank you.
All right, thank you. Thank you to Danielle and Joshua and Hannah for organizing this. Thank you for all of you for staying and for being so attentive. And I have a confession to make to begin. I am not a law professor. I'm a political science professor. And some of what I'm going to be talking about today is based on research that I did with Taryn Monahan, who's at UNC, and he's a sociologist. So we're kind of moving into a different sort of more social science perspective. But what I hope gives a nice transition from what Andrew was just talking about is I'm going to be sort of looking at the institutional context, or one of the institutional contexts in which this sort of big data predictive policing takes place, and talk a bit about how it evolved and what some of the key issues are. So, fusion centers, does this work? Okay, just hit the middle one. Okay, so fusion centers came about as a result of the 9/11 Commission, with the emphasis, with the concern that one of the lessons to be learned from 9/11 was that we were not very good at connecting the dots. So how do we begin to connect the dots? Part of this was the more sort of information sharing environment, which is very much a component of kind of big data, putting a bunch of data systems together, trying to get to see the links and the connections in those datas, in that data. And some of it was institutional. So if we had fusion centers, if we could set up an operation in which we could have public-private sharing of information, people working together, sort of crossing over the sort of traditional silos that we would have in certain organizations, that would make a difference. So fusion centers came about as a result of this. They got a big push in the years following 9/11. Most of the initial funding was coming from the Department of Homeland Security, but there was also funding from the states and funding from the local government. So you really kind of have this, you know, this sort of institutional context that is also mirroring the kind of networking and connectivity that you've got with this concept of information sharing environment. Some of the fusion centers were newly created after 9/11 with a focus on terrorism. Some of them emerged following the principle of follow the money from existing entities where funding had sort of dried up. So drug trafficking, crime task forces, immigration. But the original purpose of the fusion centers was to be terrorism. Almost all of them have migrated or mutated to all crimes and then later all hazards. And the rationalization for this sort of migration is that so many behaviors that are precursors to terrorism resemble those that are precursors to crime. So this sort of pre-operational behaviors of concern. Okay, so just a little bit of sort of reality check here. As of January 2017, there are now 101 fusion centers. 53 of these are what DHS refers to as primary. So one in every state and in the territories and in DC. And then there's 48 that are recognized. And the recognized fusion centers are the ones that receive less federal funding and have more of a kind of urban focus and state and local focus. Interestingly, of the recognized fusion centers, 7 of them are in Texas and 6 of them are in California. So that it's sort of a little bit of, you know, sort of the border issues seem to be of interest here to the fusion centers, the southern border. August 2013, we've seen an increase in these. There were only 78 of them then, and only 25 recognized ones. So there's been a jump in those that are recognized. The titles of these fusion centers vary, and they give you some indication of the different focuses that they have. So some of them are called fusion centers, some are intelligence, threat analysis, joint crime, information and analysis, information and intelligence, all source, crime prevention, terrorism. The emphasis in all of these, however, is very much on information, intelligence, and analysis. So I'm going to talk about three issues that have to do with fusion centers and with this, with some of exactly the same things that we've been talking about all day. So one of them has to do, the first issue has to do with the blending and the blurring. And when these were originally established, DHS said that the goal here was to blend relevant law enforcement and intelligence information and analytics with to reduce threats in communities. So you've got this, you know, sort of a number of dimensions on which we've got this blurring. Law enforcement, internal security, national security. And under internal security, you also have the kind of disasters, okay, you know, the FEMA type of things. You've got a blending of federal, state, local, and tribal, because all of that is involved. Blending of public and private, as Andrew was talking about with the technology people, Palantir in the room, that very much is happening in the fusion centers. Blending between investigation, analysis, and then prediction. Community, blending between community policing, intelligence-led policing, the blending of sort of what's everyday behavior, what and what might be precursors or indicators of terrorist or criminal behavior, and then the blending between, you know, uniform police and communities and data crunchers at computers. So you saw the data, you know, the computers, which are very much in fusion centers, but that same kind of, you know, computer is in the, are in the police cars as well. So there's that connection between what's happening in the fusion centers and what is happening on the street. Second issue, accountability. These are, as I say, networks. So one of the difficulties in networks is where's the accountability? If you're looking at this, and Torin and I looked at it in one article, very much in the sort of federalism context. So here, if you're operating across jurisdictional boundaries with different regulatory and legal environments, plus you're serving multiple goals, and because of those two, you know, any one of those alone would make it difficult to have accountability, but it's even harder to have accountability when you're dealing with both of those. When you look at fusion centers, you look at the literature on fusion centers. We interviewed people in fusion centers. We did 56 interviews. There's a lot of contradictory messages. You got from DHS the sort of more centralized, top-down, traditional kind of, you know, sort of bureaucratic hierarchy, but the information sharing environment and this idea of co-locating, you know, sort of different levels of government and different policy arenas of government in one place, you know, sort of adds another message to how we should be operating or how they should be operating. So you've got a tension between centralized and decentralized policy, and you've got the state and local governments not only wanting to shape it to their needs, but for political purposes having to shape it to those needs to get that funding from them. So it's a very complex, nested framework in which you're trying to establish some sort of accountability. And we looked at this in terms of five dimensions. So one is the various policy areas and the different policy areas. So if you take law enforcement, you take anti-terrorism, and you take sort of disaster identification, infrastructure protection. Just take those four areas. They're, to a certain extent, going to define threats and priorities differently, but they're operating in one place. You've got the force of federal regulations and guidelines which tend in this environment to be somewhat ambiguous, kind of more boilerplate. You've got a lot of reliance on memorandum of understanding, which are vaguely written and also very hard to get access to. And you've got a bunch of performance measures. So a lot of the kind of accountability has been based more on sort of process and not as much based on sort of outcomes. So this has made it difficult. And the oversight structure on the federal side is very complex. There's a number of different, this is not your sort of principal agent kind of accountability structure. It's much messier than that because you've got so many federal agencies that are involved. And on the state side, the primary link in terms of accountability and oversight is the law enforcement. And most of the people on the state side who work in these fusion centers are former or current or former police. Then the third issue, and I am really having trouble with that. The third issue is this interesting thing of suspicious activity reports, because you've got this all this new technology that's being used, and at the same time, you've got all these old traditional law enforcement kind of methods. And suspicious activity reports are one of them. I mean, yesterday I was getting on Metro. As soon as, you know, I got off at Foggy Bottom, it was, you know, if you see something, say something, blaring out. So we're still very much in that kind of environment. So the suspicious activity reports, hotlines, neighborhood watches, all of those things, often of dubious, not even often, you know, like 90% of the time, of dubious quality, results in information overload. It takes an awful lot of time to invest and determine the accuracy of these. Fusion centers, interestingly enough, are emerging as the primary site for vetting and interpreting these suspicious activity reports. So you've got this sort of FBI eGuardian system that, and they've established certain guidelines and processes to try to figure out, okay, when is a suspicious activity report, and when does that rise to the level that it should be included in the larger database? But at the same time, the information is still there, and pieces of that information are getting incorporated into other databases. So we're not really controlling the accuracy of the suspicious activity reports as much as they need to be. So problems with defining what suspicious is, you know, trying to interpret these is difficult, and a lot of the interpretation now is algorithmically based. The time we started this, the word big data was not used. Algorithms was used, but definitely this is indeed an environment in which there is big data. Location-based, as was discussed earlier, is part of it, and that is last slide. Basically, we've got three privacy concerns here. A lot of the reporting in suspicious activity reports is a result of the person who's doing the reporting, their stereotypes or their fears, which often then results in racial or ethnic profiling. Sometimes the information in suspicious activity reports, let's say it's, you know, the plumber that goes into somebody's house, you're gleaning information from accessing a private space that government officials would not be able to access without a warrant. And then the information, of course, can be linked to a particular person and gets into a persistent database. So those are sort of the traditional privacy problems that are part of the suspicious activity reports. So those are three issues that we may or may not want to discuss in more detail later. Okay.
Which, using what, just the arrows?
Yeah, just the arrows.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much to everyone for having me, for being here, as my co-panelists have said. I'm really excited to be talking about these issues. And I also just want to set out for a moment how what I'm going to be talking about really connects, actually, with what Andrew and Pris have both been talking about. So I'm going to be talking about how social media is used by law enforcement, both kind of some of the actual, like, what do we know? What are the statistics? What are the kinds of cases where they use it? And also talking about how the Fourth Amendment might overlay on that. And I will just say, kind of starting that out, social media information is used in predictive policing, and it's used in fusion centers. It is pulled into so many areas of law enforcement, local, state, federal, intelligence gathering, investigation. So it really kind of interlocks with these kinds of law enforcement activity that we've been talking about. So. I want to start out just by talking a tiny bit about what we know so far. So the Brennan Center, where I work, we put together basically a map looking at local and state jurisdictions and police agencies, police departments across the country that we think use social media monitoring. The reason we think that is because these are all jurisdictions that we have sort of a subscription to a procurement database. It has a bunch of public procurement orders, so you can see, you know, what is a city buying and how much are they paying for it. So we focused on state, cities, and police departments. They're spending at least $10,000 on software packages that do social media monitoring. And for all of these, we had at least some reason to think that they were using it specifically for law enforcement purposes. There are a whole variety of things that you could use social media technologies for. Some of it could be outward facing, you know, we're tweeting out information. Some of it could be monitoring, but more for, you know, you run a university and you want to see what people are talking about on campus, things like that. For all of these, there was at least some basic reason to think that there was a good chance that this was being used for law enforcement purposes, for investigations, for intelligence. So we got to at least 156 jurisdictions that are using these technologies. There are probably more. This isn't a comprehensive procurement database. This is basically the cities and departments that kind of decide to report their information to it. And this was looking at 2010 through 2016. So thinking about the figures. What we saw, kind of adding it up, there was almost $6 million being spent since 2010. There were some really high spenders that kind of stuck out. And if you want to look at the map more kind of on your own time, basically if you Google Brennan Center social media map, or if you go to the Brennan Center website, www.brennancenter.org, you can pull this up. There are little kind of tabs for each city that show you what the spending is. You can literally click through to every single procurement order. There's information about the company or the software that each of them uses, so you can kind of dig down into that. So there are a whole bunch of departments and cities that are spending $10,000, $50,000, something like that. Then there were some really big spenders. And for some of these, this is in 1 year. For some of these, this is over several years, so it's not sort of totally apples to apples. For whatever, Pennsylvania County, Virginia, all of a sudden popped up. They actually hadn't even been on our map until we're sort of in like a monthly process. If we go back through the database, see what has come up since we looked at it last time. All of a sudden, Pennsylvania County seems to have spent $300,000 on social media monitoring. And then there are some bigger ones. You know, the Florida Department of Law Enforcement, right? So that's an entire statewide department, County of LA. LA is huge and does a lot of predictive policing, right? And also has a fusion center. So it is probably no surprise that these things are kind of intersecting Harris County, Texas, where Dallas is, again, a very big county. There are a bunch of different kinds of companies. We looked at 8 of them. A lot of the highest spenders had purchased several of them. So maybe they bought one, tried it out for a couple of years, moved on to the next one. And basically, in short, what these companies do is they pull from Twitter, they pull from Facebook, they pull from Instagram, kind of the big social media platforms, and give law enforcement agencies and cities ways to follow individual people, to kind of crunch data. I'll talk about some of the specific cases in a moment. And then the last thing that I want to highlight here is that very, very few of those jurisdictions have publicly available policies for how they use this. Some of them do. We found 18 out of 156. Some of the departments and cities have publicly available policies, but it's along the lines of, if you are at a local police department and you want to tweet out information about the block party, where a community can come meet the police department, what are the rules? Can you have your own Twitter account that uses your, you know, police handle, things like that? So many of them focus on kind of the outward facing. There are not that many that focus on and give the public information about how they would be used for investigations and intelligence. This was just a quick breakdown. So the International Association of Chiefs of Police does a study, I think every year, their 2016 study hasn't come out yet. As you can tell, almost every single agency that responded uses social media in some capacity, a very high percentage for criminal investigations, 3/4 for intelligence, and then a little over half for listening slash monitoring. So quite a high percentage that are using it. It's not just to speak to the public, but also to collect information and use it in various ways. So how do they use it? I wanted to outline quickly sort of 4 different ways, and then we're going to talk through some case studies as well. And I ordered these kind of in order of what I would see as some combination of least intrusive and least problematic from a Fourth Amendment point of view, down to what seems potentially more problematic and also just much more opaque. So the first kind of most obvious one is, you know, I am a police officer and there is somebody that I'm interested in and I would literally just like to look at their public tweets or their public Facebook profile. And as you can see here, of the agencies that responded to the International Association of Chiefs and Police, over 90% of them said that they use social media in some way to look at profiles and activities of suspects, right? And in a lot of ways, that is fairly straightforward. The second would be getting information about somebody they're interested in from basically a friend, so a cooperating witness, an informant, but a friend of the target, who can see their private postings. So, you know, I'm a police officer, I'm interested in somebody, but they have set their Facebook settings to private, I can't see it, but I know somebody who knows them, I have some leverage over that person, and I can say, look, can you please report back to me about their postings that I can't see, or maybe even their messages, their direct messages that they're sending to you. So that's sort of the next one. The third is creating a fake undercover account to connect with somebody and then use that information. So you don't have to go through a friend, through a cooperating witness. You know, you set up a nice account, it has like a pretty picture, you create sort of a fake bio, and you reach out and friend somebody. And if the target is the kind of person who randomly accepts friend requests from people they don't know, which turn out to be, I think, a large percentage of people, then you can see what they're posting, right? There's then the next question about whether they're going to exchange direct messages with you, but you're then sort of in to see more than you would be able to otherwise. And as you can see here, about 2/3 of agencies use an undercover identity to collect information on social media. Then the fourth way, and a lot of that can be done through these companies that are pulling information from the social media platforms. One of the things they provide usually is a capability to set up those undercover accounts. And then the fourth one is using the software to do much bigger data crunching. So this is really getting into the big data piece that both Andrew and Priscilla were talking about. You know, they can track hashtags writ large. They can do really sort of social network analysis for who's connecting with each other, who's talking with each other about certain things, at kind of a level and a depth that's more than just like me searching on Twitter for, oh, what have the tweets been recently about, you know, who knows, whatever hashtag I'm interested in. There's a lot more data crunching that they can do. So one of the ways that plays out is police using social media monitoring software to monitor protests. So this is a copy of an email that the ACLU got through a public records request. The ACLU of Northern California did request to something like 65 law enforcement agencies in California to try to figure out how they were using social media monitoring software, how those software companies were marketing to them, things like that. So this was from a salesperson, basically, for a company called Geofedia, which has been in the news a fair amount. And as you can see, hopefully, from our nifty little red boxes here, they're kind of selling themselves. And one of the ways that they sell themselves is to say things like, we covered Ferguson / Mike Brown protests nationally. There's a question about how many fake accounts you can use. They say there's no limit on fake accounts. So they're really kind of selling themselves as, we can help you monitor anything, right? Whatever it is out there, whatever public safety concerns you have, we can monitor protesters, we can monitor people who are gathering together for associations, we can help you set up lots and lots of fake undercover accounts. One of the interesting pieces about this is that, in part because of the work that the ACLU did, they put this out publicly and they spoke with the companies, several of the big social media monitoring companies have now been cut off from the platforms themselves. So Twitter has been kind of out front, they cut off Geofedia, they cut off several other companies. It doesn't mean that those companies can't still look at those platforms and gather information, but what they had access to was something called the fire hose, which was basically all of the daily information coming through, and they could crunch that in a variety of ways. It's way more than just an average member of the public would have access to. And Twitter basically said, you are violating our terms of service by doing all of this law enforcement work that you're doing, and you're now cut off. So that has actually been a big change recently. And this is also similarly an email that ACLU got, and again from somebody from Geofedia, saying district attorneys around the country are interested in monitoring protests and investigations. That's why they're moving towards using our service. So another thing that they can do is collect location information. And in some ways, this wouldn't be surprising. So, you know, on Facebook, on Twitter, presumably on Instagram, which I don't use, you know, you can enable your location, you can check in, you can say where you are. So for that, it's certainly not surprising they would know where you are. But they can also find location information even if that isn't enabled through a couple of different things. So some of them can mine Wi-Fi and cellular data, social media handles, and the content of the postings to infer where you are. Raytheon, a defense contractor, put together a program that could track interpersonal relationships and location data. This was based on kind of social media histories, and so then they could predict where users would be in the future based on their social media histories. Can also look at hashtags, content posted within sort of a certain geographic range and filter that down. So there's a lot of fairly granular tracking that these companies can do, even if you're kind of taking the basic privacy steps to disenable some of that location tracking. So I'm going to go through a few case studies and then talk about where the cases have been, where the Fourth Amendment cases have been so far, and what I think may be coming down the line in terms of some of the newer Fourth Amendment case law. So I'm calling this, it's not quite the good, the bad, and the ugly. It's like the okay, probably, the bad, and the like, it doesn't seem so great. So starting out with, frankly, the probably okay. So the first is this case in Racine, Wisconsin. The suspect in the murder of a teenager posted rap lyrics. And for me, I do First Amendment stuff, and part I'm very interested and feel very strongly about the First Amendment. You sort of think, oh, you know, you're making a decision, you know, a prosecution decision based on lyrics. Well, you know, the lyrics talk about the murder, they talk about the victim's name. So at some point, it sounds a little more like a confession that is simply posted in lyric form. So that is a way that social media was used after the 2011 riots, after the Canucks won, I think. I'm pretty sure that was the way it went, where there were sort of big riots in downtown Vancouver. They used social media to crowdsource, basically to find people. And then sort of a similar story, somebody who I'm not actually sure why throwing a football at a squad car was a huge deal. That might be a separate question. But the police were evidently very interested in finding the person, and there was a video that had been put up publicly. So again, you know, there's a video of the person who's doing it. It happens to be put up on social media. That's not the kind of thing that necessarily gives me huge amounts of heartburn. So then the bad. I was talking before about how the social media companies are kind of marketing themselves in terms of tracking protests. So the Oakland, California and Salem, Oregon police departments were monitoring Black Lives Matter protests and hashtags. So much so that the director of civil rights at the Oregon Department of Justice, which was targeted because he was posting tweets that said hashtag Black Lives Matter. Needless to say, this was very awkward and he was very angry. So the attorney general ended up ordering the law enforcement division to stop using this monitoring software because it had clearly kind of gone to being abused and misused very quickly. Somewhat similarly, there's another case in which the DEA had seized somebody's cell phone, had taken pictures off it of her and her children, and then had used those to create one of these fake accounts to try to loop other people in a drug trafficking ring. But the upshot was that this woman's actual picture was out there kind of as the face of this drug investigation. So again, this did not go over well. She came across this and discovered it. The DEA ended up having to settle for about $135,000. And then the questionable, but these I think go into the bad. It's just that they haven't been tested in court quite so much. It's not as obvious, I think, how courts are going to deal with this. So I'll take the first and the third together, which is that especially in New York, information on Facebook is being used increasingly in gang indictments. Often, this kind of connects to one of the things that Andrew was talking about before. It's generally focused on communities of color and especially focused on youth of color who are monitored very significantly, not only sort of in like real life, but also on social media. And so information about what they're doing on Facebook, liking something on Facebook. If there's somebody who is quote unquote known to be in a gang and somebody else, likes a video of something that they put up that is gang related, that is taken as evidence basically of gang involvement or gang conspiracy. So the NYPD is very heavily into social media use. It's showing up more and more in gang-related indictments. There was a teen named Jelani Henry who is indicted on gang conspiracy charges, in large part due to Facebook likes. He spent about 2 years in Riker, including a pretty significant amount of time in solitary. For a case that was built largely on social media. And similarly, the NYPD Intelligence Division sort of uses social media to monitor things generally. So the last piece I want to get to is where is the case law right now in terms of the Fourth Amendment? How does it apply to monitoring social media? So there aren't a bunch of cases. There are one or two in addition to the three that are here. This is not a particularly well-explored area so far. The first one now from, 16 years ago, which is why it refers to an electronic bulletin board, which I don't think we have anymore exactly things that we describe that way. But an undercover police officer went on and looked at this undercover bulletin board. And the court, the Sixth Circuit, basically said that's fine under the third party doctrine. That information was in the hands of somebody else. It was in the hands of the provider who ran that bulletin board. So that's fine. There's no Fourth Amendment claim. And then several in the last couple of years. So the middle one, U.S. v. Marigildo, this was an informant case. So the informant was friends with the defendant. He looked at his posts and then reported what he was seeing to the government. And here, the court said, it's true, he had an interest in keeping that private. Because of the way he had set his privacy settings, he did think that he had an expectation of privacy. But once you're publishing something and you know that your friends can see it, and it's almost sort of basic informant Fourth Amendment case law, you always take the risk that the person that you're talking to could be a government agent or could be a government informant. And basically, it's no different when you're operating online. You're taking the same risk. And so similarly, in this recent New Jersey case, a police officer created an Instagram account so they could then connect with somebody. And basically, this was one of those situations where the defendant accepted a friend request, either thinking that he knew the person or just sort of not caring. This friend request came in, and the court said, once you accepted it, you knew that somebody else was going to be seeing that information. So that being said, where could Fourth Amendment case law go in the future on this? And I think there are a couple of cases that could be pulled in at some point. So the first is Riley v. California, where the Supreme Court held a couple of years ago that when police search a cell phone of an arrestee incident to arrest, that is very different from searching something like a wallet, a cigarette pack, anything that might contain contraband or be kind of a risk or a threat to the officer. They said, a cell phone, you can call it a phone, you can call it a camera, you can call it a Rolodex, kind of anything can be stored in there. And so there are much higher privacy interests. So if you're talking about accessing social media through somebody's phone, which could happen, and that's a whole separate discussion that's been happening a lot at the border recently, I think there are arguments to say that when you're talking about these kinds of devices, there are higher privacy interests. Also, obviously, in U.S. v. Jones, this shadow opinion that I know that Oren is not a fan of, but let's just call it the shadow opinion, there are five justices that say, look, even if you're talking about publicly available information, so there was where you travel on public roads, here it's what you're posting publicly, once you are getting a large enough quantity of it or delving deeply into it, then there are privacy interests that come into play. And so I think when you're talking about the software programs that crunch these vast amounts of data, that's when it starts to look different from I'm just looking at what an individual person posts. And then the last is a border case from the Ninth Circuit, again speaking to devices, you know, so how would you actually be looking at this information, and that there has to be reasonable suspicion to do searches. So again, that could erect also a little bit more of a barrier. And I will stop mine there because I think I've gone over time.
Thank you all very much for some very interesting comments on very important topics. We have about 15 minutes left, so I want to open it up to questions as soon as possible. And I might want to just start with my own question first, if I may. And it kind of picks up on what Rachel was just talking about. It seems that, on the one hand, it seems natural, I think, that law enforcement would avail itself of more technological capabilities as these technologies develop. I think it only makes sense for law enforcement to try to use new technologies to help itself in its investigations. So there's a lot more capability on that side. And then on the other hand, it seems like people in general, maybe this is more true of a younger generation than an older generation, but people seem to be willing, a lot more willing to share personal information with each other or with the public, and they don't really think about what they might post on social media, might not think about the ramifications of posting on social media and what that might mean for their own privacy. So I'm wondering, what does that mean anything? On the one hand, we have these capabilities. On the other hand, there's so much more information out there that perhaps people are even willing to share voluntarily. What does that mean for traditional concepts of surrounding the Fourth Amendment? What is a reasonable search? What does it mean for the concept of an expectation of privacy? Where do we see this going, if anywhere? Do we see these traditional concepts changing? So I just want to throw that out to the panel and see if what your reaction might be to that.
Sure, I'm happy to start. Is this on? So, I mean, I think this is an area that is in enormous flux. I think it is probably more or getting to be better developed when we're talking about sort of surveillance of movements in private. There's more scholarship on this. There's getting to be more case law on it. Especially there's a lot of case law right now on things like how you can track somebody using their cell phone. And there are a lot of courts saying, you know, if you're getting a lot of information about where somebody goes by virtue of their cell phone records, then that actually does create Fourth Amendment issues. You know, in terms of the social media, like I said, it isn't something that's been explored yet. And I think in some ways, I see it as a little more difficult. I think there's a case to be made, and I hope that it's a case that we will be making. On the other hand, you know, if you're choosing to post things on social media, I guess I don't know if we're going to end up getting into kind of debates over how obvious is the information that you're posting. So one of the things that we've talked about in the context of kind of surveillance of where you go in public is like, well, you can infer all these things based on where somebody goes or based on the order in which they go. They're kind of similar to phone calls. There's this metadata that allows you to, you know, infer things. With social media, if what you're posting is literally that information, you know, I just went to the doctor, I just called my mom, you know, the things that we think you can infer through other stuff, if you are literally making those statements public, I think there's a harder case to be made that even in the aggregate, there's a privacy interest there because you are making it so explicitly public. So I don't know exactly what that's going to look like. If what you're posting is more oblique somehow or more opaque, and then kind of the crunching is pulling out information, is pulling inferences out, either of what you're saying or things like this location information or who you're near at various points when you're posting, then I think it gets closer to some of the case law that we've seen in sort of the location tracking context, where maybe there's a better argument that you're not actually trying to make kind of the inferences public. You're trying to keep those private, and that's being extracted anyway.
So I think this gets to the sort of privacy and public debate that has been going on for a number of years. And I think everything that we know from public opinion surveys, from focus groups with individuals, is that because people post something or because people give up information in a certain, you know, to use Helen Nissenbaum, in a certain context or with a certain group of people, does not necessarily mean that they think or desire that that information would become public. And we have this sort of privacy paradox that people act in one way, they act to reveal parts of themselves, but at the same time they value privacy. So to sort of make the jump from, in my mind, I would argue, making the jump from the fact that people have revealed information to then assume that they don't have an expectation of privacy is a big leap. And I don't think it's a leap we should be making either legally or socially or culturally. The other piece of this is the kind of opaqueness of how tracking is actually going on. And part of that is the, you know, the lack of real information in those privacy statements. Part of it is understanding how various institutions are working. Like, do people know what, you know, the law enforcement is picking up, for example, on social media? And then part of that is also the math of this. The algorithms are incredibly complex. So it's opaque in at least three ways. And I think that also muddies the water in terms of Fourth Amendment.
I think it means a lot of work for law professors who write about the Fourth Amendment. I have killed a lot of trees trying to reconceptualize the Fourth Amendment not as about privacy, but about security, not collective security like Professor Gray, but more of a thinking that the idea of to be secure, to exclude yourself, exclude others from your information, both where you are, what you're doing, but also the data you're giving up, is key. If you think about it, if you, any of you have been to Manhattan and you have driven to Manhattan, which is a mistake, but if you have, your license plate has been tagged as soon as you drove in. There are 9,000 linked cameras that are connected to a domain awareness system that watches you, it has automatic alerts. There are sensors for, usually it's sensors for like terrorism-related things. And if you have a smartphone, which you do, or a Fitbit, which you may, or you're giving up information through a host of other things, like you're giving up that privacy. Privacy is a wrong frame. It is obviously what came from cats. It's, you know, an old case now, and it may need to be rethought. But it's a really, it just doesn't fit anymore. Like, we are giving up our privacy all the time. And so when you say you have a reasonable expectation of privacy, it's really hard to reconceptualize it. So I think you need to look, you know, the Fourth Amendment doesn't talk about privacy, it talks about security, the right to be secure, collective security or individual security as you see it. And I think that the task is, and I say this, again, I was serious about my opening statement, like, there are no answers here, right? We're sitting here, you're sitting there, but we don't know any more than you do, right? And this is a place for ideas and someone else who can come up with the way to reconceptualize privacy, because your privacy is my privacy, and there is the fact that some people write law review articles, which no one reads, and some people just think about it or blogs. We haven't solved it yet, and we have to solve it because it affects all of our rights to be doing what we want to do and not being tracked by people we don't want to be tracked. And so we don't have an answer yet. I think the old framework of the Fourth Amendment is just lacking, and it needs a new framework. And if you read the Jones case, you know, the five concurring opinions, like, is actually kind of disappointing. Like, supposedly the smartest minds in America came up with what Justice Sotomayor and Justice Alito came up with, which was kind of vague and really didn't work. And if you think about it hard, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And so it's open. And so I hope someone in this room comes up with it, because we're going to need these answers pretty soon.
Thanks. Okay, questions? Yeah.
Thank you. And thank you all for your presentations. As a, when in my lefty days of government surveillance, I have a lot of sensitivity to the civil liberties. But I think I have a different perspective, and not so much on the social media stuff, but on the big data, is my experience, and I live in a minority community in a minority county, and have been in law, been a prosecutor for a long time, as well as a political leader. But I start with the premise that crime is bad. And we haven't talked about that, right? But crime destroys communities and lives, and such huge costs, and those costs are overwhelmingly in communities of color. So stopping crime, reducing crime, is a useful sort of thing. Now, it has to be done in a way that doesn't violate the rights that people have, the constitutional rights of doing that. But so that's, I guess, my problem with, and I understand I'm setting you up as a sort of straw man, professor, but with the critique of big data, because the big data is useful. It is, and I think you said it yourself, it's pretty accurate. Is it predictive? It is effective. It allows for efficient use of resources, and it prevents crime. Now, we don't want the bad uses of that, and you cited some examples, but I mean, in my county, in Prince George's County, they use predictive models that are based on actual crime instances to try to allocate resources around in the community to make a difference. That's what we need. That's far better than the old model, which was based on prejudice and opinion and all sorts of other things that aren't of any value. So I think we have to be careful not to confuse the technology and the ability to collect data with just the examples where it's misused. And the corrections for the misuse of data are the ones we've always had, which is the Constitution. That's search and seizure, search warrants. That's what's happening with, we don't do a telephone data, we don't do social media data without a search warrant, right? And some of that's because you can't get data from Facebook and a lot of the media companies without a search warrant. You can't get data, certain kinds of data without having it, or if you don't have your warrant, it gets suppressed. So those are the checks historically on the abuse. Now, we may need some additional things that could be put in to control abuses, but it's not the problem of being able to pull this together. There is no constitutional right for somebody to commit a crime and get away with it and to not be caught. Right? They have constitutional rights to protect them from searches and seizures, but they have no right to be not caught. And I think we have to remember that and put that sort of in the start of our framework of this discussion. And when we do that, we get a lot more support from folks who might, like the people I work with, who would be much more ready to rant and rave about it.
You know, I think I agree with you in the sense, obviously, crime is bad. And I'm agnostic about you can't fight the technology, right? The technology will develop. The question is, what do you do with it, right? And what are the questions you're asking beforehand to make sure you don't run into questions of racial bias, which can be infected by the data, but it seems sort of sanitized because it's database and objective, about the lack of transparency, the fact, you know, if you are using these technologies and you're informing your communities you're doing it, and you're telling them that these are the people you're putting on the list and this is why, and that they have a say politically in the community about whether they want you to use it and whether it makes sense as a, you know, elected a leader, like, that makes sense. If you're open with them and you're explaining, like, look, you know, the idea behind the heat list was a public health model, right? It was like, if we know that smoking causes cancer, kind of makes sense to go talk to people and says, by the way, you know, smoking increases your risk. That's great. In the violence context, you know, it began with the idea that in addition to the detective at the door, you'd also have a social worker and a football coach who say, look, your son's on the wrong path. We've got to move him off this path. What happened, unfortunately, in Chicago was they came up with a list, and they didn't really fund or work through having the social worker or the coach go, and they just used it sort of as a shorthand of who we can arrest on this been a shooting. And there have been plenty of shootings in Chicago, which is destroying that community, right? So it's complicated, right? The idea is, it's obviously not crime is not good, and obviously technology is not good or bad. It's how you use it, and what are the mechanisms to be able to make sure you are building in concerns about racial bias, about transparency, and also about how it affects the law. You say you need a warrant to go to Facebook. You know, that's an open question. Like, that's not really, it's a third party, the third party doctrine. You guys are being smart by doing it, so you save your prosecution because it hasn't fully been litigated yet, but it's not clear. We don't know the answer. The Supreme Court doesn't know the answer, and thus lower courts don't know the answer of how these new technologies will impact the Fourth Amendment. It's good that you're being cautious about it. That's great. But it's not, the constitutional bar is pretty low, and so I think we want to think about this at the front end. And then there are a whole host of other issues about, you know, it's not so much the right to commit a crime, it's the right to live your life without government interference. Like, the founders were committing a few crimes at their day, they were concerned about the people, you know, it's complex in its way, but your point's taken. And the point of my work has always been to engage with the police who are using it, and I found actually great response where the folks in LA, the LAPD, who read my stuff say, you know, we hadn't thought about this. This is actually helpful to think through so we can avoid the lawsuit, so we can avoid the challenge of racial bias, so we can avoid this because we're police officers. We don't have time to worry about what you law professors do. And so thank you. It helps. And so I agree with you that it's useful to have a positive interaction with that, these ideas.
Can I add two quick things to that? And I you know, defer to Andrew on most of the predictive policing stuff. He's done a ton of the work in this area. Just really to add two things on top of that. One is that, you know, you were making the point that it's sort of, you know, effective and efficient use of resources. I think that's not always the case, right? So there are a lot of police departments that have used predictive policing technologies for a year or two and then decided, you know what, in the scheme of things, this is not the way that we want to spend our money. We're not getting enough bang for the buck. We're not getting any bang for the buck. So I think that's one issue. And I think the other, you know, it is, I feel like a lot of the fun, juicy questions are about, okay, we have this technology, we're using it, and then what's the legal overlay, what's the policy overlay? But there is also a huge question about, do we use these technologies or do we do something totally different? So for instance, in Chicago, my understanding, and somebody can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but that at least some of the spike in murders came after basically a community program that had been funded was no longer funded, right? So then there are a lot of things that kind of rush into that vacuum. There's a debate that's going on in DC right now where I am about whether there are going to be hundreds more police officers funded or a basically kind of community involvement program that's been approved by the city council. And that wouldn't involve more police officers, which also means doesn't involve more technology, right? So when you're sending out officers, they're wearing body cameras, they're putting license plate readers on their cars, they're potentially using predictive policing technologies, but there could be even an earlier step at which you decide, and absolutely for the crime fighting function, right? Because you actually think that this has like a useful impact in terms of community safety, that you decide to do something totally different, which then means potentially, you know, kind of lessening the use of these technologies in the first place.
Also, two points. One is the debate here in terms of sort of the risks and benefits of big data. That is being debated in all the contexts in which we're using big data. And I think you make it, you know, sort of an important point that we don't want to weigh too heavily just on one side. The other point is that with the big data in the law enforcement context and the sort of question of resources, using big data, does that mean that we then start to target certain kinds of crime or certain areas and other types of crimes or other areas, people get away with things? So that there's, you know, sort of a question of sort of the fairness there. And that's an open question, I think.
Josh, how are we on time? Do we have more time for questions? One more question?
My name is Matt Bodman. I'm an adjunct at UB. I teach cyberspace law and privacy law. So I have a question in terms of So a lot of the topics that I've seen up here, talk about misplaced trust, third-party doctrine, kind of Kylo. These are the cases that underpin all of these decisions, right? These are just like super foundational things we've relied on in a number of different ways. Doesn't seem like we're going to do away with them anytime soon. Have we thought about things like, having civil liberties and privacy offices? When I talk about the data, right, the policing. If you had a civil liberties and privacy office who had insight into how the police were doing these things, it might have a voice, if you will, right? This is kind of thing has been done with the IC community, and it's been successful, PCLOBs and other things. Have we thought about whether or not it's, I understand that those law professors would like to talk about legal solutions, but it seems like this might be, you know, something that would be viable in the short term.
Yeah, I mean, in the end of my book, I propose, I struggled with that. Like, so what's the solution, as you just point out? And I sort of came up with sort of surveillance summits that are both local, state, and national to discuss what's happening, which is, has a double edge, right? It's part of the beauty of surveillance is that people don't know, like criminals don't know what's happening. But the problem with mass surveillance technologies is also hitting everyone. And so if you had these moments of accountability where people had to come up and explain it, I think if you look at the outrage of the surveillance techniques, most of them happen when there's been something secret and then it's been done. Mm-hmm. Like New York City is overt about how crazily surveilled you are, and no one seems to bat an eye about it. Maybe it's the history of New York and 9/11 and the rest of it, but it's different, right? They've been open about it and people haven't fought in the same way, whereas it's more of like the reveal of what do you mean you are flying a plane over West Baltimore and surveilling everything that happens and giving it to the police and the prosecutors. Like, that was a problem because it was secret. It wasn't told. There weren't even the city council didn't know about it. So I think if there's this moment of sort of democratic accountability to say, this is what we're having, this is what we're spending your tax dollars on, and this is why it matters to us. Maybe you get buy-in, maybe you don't. There are obviously problems because not all communities are as politically engaged, and what you can imagine is those communities that are not politically engaged are the ones that we targeted more. But that kind of sort of non-legal public airing of what's happening and forcing the politicians, the prosecutors, and the police to justify why they're spending this money on a black box algorithm and not a basketball program or whatever it would be, right? Mentoring, whatever, it's a choice.
I agree with you that sort of institutional mechanisms are important. But I think they need to be sort of so like you were talking about privacy officer type of things. So something ahead of time that does a privacy impact statement, but then on the tail, on that other end of that, I think you need audits to see exactly what is being done. We've got a bunch of privacy impact statements out there in different contexts. And we really don't have the kind of IG type of follow-up to see, are they doing what they say they're doing? So I think you need it at both ends.
There's not much I would add. I mean, there are a couple of cities where they're sort of trying to try something like this. Oakland now has sort of a, privacy council. I think Seattle does too. And it seems incredibly important. So I would just agree with the points that both Andrew and Pris made.
All right. Are we out of time? Okay. Well, please join me in thanking our panel again.
At this point, we're going to have a couple final words from Professor Citrin. And she will use the mic.
What a day, right? I hope the consensus is that what we've seen throughout the day, I think, is a sustained argument for privacy as a social good, as a social value, right? And this is something that 22 years ago, Pris Regan, in her fabulous book, Legislating Privacy, one amongst my favorite privacy books, that is, made the argument that we should understand privacy not as individual control, right? But conceptualize it as a social good. And today, certainly, sort of panel for panel, I think what we have put to the foreground are a set of risks and harms. We're on this sort of precipice of, I guess, what did Paul Ohm say? Privacy like it's 1999, that we can foresee risks, whether it's on the private sector side, Internet of Things and robots and drones, to on the government surveillance concerns about sort of more systematic, programmatic, the sort of big data blacklisting and black policing that fusion centers and the kind of harvesting of social media and 702 data that we've seen, where I think what we are coming to understand that privacy is also a story about vulnerability and discrimination, that I might and have otherwise argued that it's like the new discrimination, right? Privacy in all these different respects. And that we need solutions that change the conversation from the FIPS individual control, right? Sometimes that works a little bit, right? But we really need to substitute some of our individually focused that were dependent upon our autonomy for privacy solutions. And so I'm gonna channel David Gray, my co-author and wonderful Fourth Amendment scholar to suggest that the Fourth Amendment is about collective rights. That some of how we're gonna address concerns about surveillance are addressing it at the programmatic level and making a set of commitments to how we protect privacy and civil liberties and speech and all the ways in which our fundamental liberties that aren't about necessarily individuated adjudication, but are about a set of commitments that we make in advance. And I think we're gonna have to do the same in the commercial sector. So today it seemed to me that every panel for panel was like, we are making the argument. So Pris, you didn't waste your time. We are listening, right? That privacy should be conceptualized as a social good, and I heard that from everyone. And it might indeed be something we need to bake into both law and how companies address it, how we all as consumers and individuals partake in a much more systematic way. And it might mean that just as we think of civil rights remedies as sort of structural, like structural injunctions, that we might have to take the same turn. And that's, I guess, for a lot of more trees that we're gonna print out and then, right, as law professors, but and practitioners and advocates. So thank you so much for today. It was a wonderful day, so incredibly informative. So on behalf of University of Maryland Law School and the Law Review, if I can speak for my CUTE students, thank you so much for being here. thank you, everybody. And it sounds like there'll be a wine and refreshments. Josh has given me the thumbs up for all of you guys to enjoy. So thank you, everybody, for a great day.